There's Nellie.
Her fiance just bought a house, so she's been helping him get all of it.
Married on Friday. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Whose kitty you got there? It's kind of cool in here.
I'm here with that budget.
That's what I'm thinking about.
Good morning. What a beautiful day to be outside. Whoever ordered the weather gets an A plus.
You're welcome. I'll take credit any time.
Way to go. Welcome to our worship today, and we're glad to have each and every one of you here and glad to be worshiping together. Don't forget that our 150th celebration is Sunday, September 29th. We're going to have worship, we're going to have a potluck, we're going to have the meat provided and the drinks and table service. So we're going to starting next week, have a sheet in the bulletin, so we need to have somewhat of a number to know how many people are going to be there. So we hope if you're planning to be there. If you have an address of somebody who was a member here, who's moved away, someone you would like invited to the 150th celebration, I bet you already got your cards. I mean, how many people got their postcard mail? It's not too late for us to send out one to folks. Just let me know an address and we'll get that to them. So we're still trying to track down some people's addresses. Our Bible study, women's Bible study, will start the Monday after Labor Day, so join us then. Are there other announcements this morning? Okay, you ready to go?
Yep.
It was
good. Please join me in the call to worship. O Lord, our Lord, the majesty of your name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. We gather to praise you.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
O Lord, our Lord, the majesty of your name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. We gather to celebrate you.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and God saw that it was good. We gather to celebrate our God.
O Lord, our Lord, the majesty of your name fills the earth. Your glory is higher than the heavens. We gather to worship you.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and God saw that it was very good. We gather to worship our God. All praise, honor, majesty, and power belongs to our creating God. Amen.
Let us pray. God is the vast universe
and the tiniest creature. We marvel at your world. It lifts our spirits. It calms our anxious moments. It delights our eyes and senses. We rejoice to call you Creator, and we lift our voices in praising you. Meet us in our praise, we pray. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Let's remain seated and join together in singing, This is My Father's World. It's on one of your handouts.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world.
loved the world, that God gave the only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God sent the Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Let us confess our need for God's saving love. Join me in prayer and confession.
They may not be beaten down or lying by the road, but there are people we pass by, watching God. Some are family and friends. We take so much for granted. We cannot see how we have stirred them with our love and compassion. Others are neighbors who have been left half dead by a crushing work, who have fallen into the hands of despair, who have been abandoned by all those who walked on by them. Many are strangers, people we don't know, but could we judge? They are weak or poor, or the enemy, or because they remind us of who we once were, or could become. Rescue us from the power of our sins, righteous one of all generations. Pour out your justice on us, rather than your judgment, that we would be moved with pity and spurred to action, that we would hear of the hope that is ours and share it with our sisters and brothers, that we would shower mercy on all we meet, even as we have received forgiveness for our sins through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.
Children of the Most High, you are forgiven and brought into the kingdom. Be filled with spiritual wisdom, lead lives worthy of your inheritance, bear fruit in all you say and do and think.
God has rescued us and redeemed us from our sins, setting aside judgment to shower us with mercy. We will go and do likewise. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Okay, let us greet those next to us.
Thank you.
Help me, kids. Okay. Jesus asked a man one day, "What must I do to live forever with God?" "What have you been taught?" said Jesus. "Love God with everything I am," answered the man, "and love my neighbor in the same way I love myself." "Good," Jesus smiled. "That's what I would have said." "But who exactly is my neighbor?" asked the man. So Jesus told him a story. There was once a man who went for a walk from Jerusalem down to Jericho.
Oh my, that's a dangerous road.
Okay. Robbers grabbed a hold of the man and beat him.
Uh-oh.
Well, hold on, okay. I thought about my phone, but one time somebody did actually call me in the middle of church, believe it or not. Okay. Robbers grabbed hold of the man and beat him and took his clothes and left him lying helpless by the side of the road.
I don't think I can watch.
Soon a priest walked by.
You help the man.
But the priest didn't. He walked by, past the helpless man and left him lying there.
Oh dear.
A man who worked at the temple came by next.
Help the man.
But he didn't either. He walked past the helpless man and left him lying there.
Oh dear.
Then a Samaritan came by.
What's a Samaritan?
The beaten man was Jewish, and Samaritans didn't believe the same things about God as Jewish people. Also, some very bad things had happened between Jews and Samaritans years and years before, so they didn't get along. So once again, a Samaritan came by.
He'll never help the man.
But he did. He bandaged his wounds.
That feels better.
He put him on his donkey.
Yeehaw!
He took him to an inn and paid the innkeeper to take care of him.
Here's some money.
And he promised to pay even more, if needed, when he returned.
And here's more money, too.
So which of the three men, Jesus asked, was a neighbor to the man who has been beaten? This time you don't get a card.
The Samaritan.
Who was it? It was the Samaritan, right? The one who showed him mercy and cared for him, answered the man who asked the question. Then you go and be a neighbor too, said Jesus. You know, we don't know how that man responded or even if he helped anyone at all. But think about it for a minute. Who needs your help? Who needs you to be a neighbor? You get an A plus for your children's homework today. You think we can do it better the next time?
Almighty God, in you are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Open our eyes that we may see the wonders of your word, and give us grace that we may clearly understand and freely choose the way of your wisdom. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Today's scripture reading is Luke 10, 25 through 37, defining neighbor. Just then, a religion scholar stood up with the question to test Jesus. "Teacher, what do I need to do to get to eternal life?" He answered, "What's written in God's law? How do you interpret it?" He said, "That you love the Lord your God with all your passion and prayer and muscle and intelligence, and that you love your neighbor as well as you do yourself." Good answer, said Jesus. Do it, and you'll live. Looking for a loophole, he asked, and just how would you define neighbor? Jesus answered by telling a story. There was once a man traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. On the way, he was attacked by robbers. They took his clothes, beat him up, and went off, leaving him half dead. Luckily, a priest was on his way down the same road. But when he saw him, he angled across the other side. Then a Levite religious man showed up. He also avoided the injured man. A Samaritan traveling the road came on him. When he saw the man's condition, his heart went out to him. He gave him first aid, disinfecting and bandaging his wounds. Then he lifted him onto his donkey, led him to an inn, and made him comfortable. In the morning, he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, "Take good care of him. If it cost any more, put it on my bill. I'll pay you on my way back." What do you think? Which of the 3 became a neighbor to the man attacked by robbers? The one who treated him kindly, the religion scholar responded. Jesus said, "Go and do the same."
In 1959, Vince Lombardi inherited the Green Bay Packers at the lowest point of their history as a professional football team. And after losing 10 of their 12 games the previous season, it seemed that they had nowhere to go but up. But after losing 5 straight games, Lombardi began to wonder. And he gathered the team and announced his intention to get back to the basics. He then picked up a ball and said, "Gentlemen, this is a football." Max McGee, a notorious cut-up, replied from the back of the squad, "Coach, could you slow down a little? You're going too fast for us." Now, Lombardi laughed, but he quickly refocused the team. And though surrounded by tons of football experience, the time had come to wipe the slate clean and to start from scratch. The most ingenious playbook in the league won't help a team win if players have forgotten how to block, tackle, pass, catch, and run. Now, by the time Jesus entered his ministry, the most visible examples of Judaism had reduced godliness to a list of rules and rituals so complicated that nobody could maintain it. Even worse, the rules and the rituals caused those religious experts to forget the basics, to love God and to love one's neighbor. And as Jesus journeyed to Jerusalem, much attention is being paid on what it means to be a real disciple. And here, a question comes from someone outside the disciple group, and it prompts Jesus to illustrate the central demand of discipleship by telling one of his best-loved parables. We can agree that this parable is one that even people who don't know the Bible know about the Good Samaritan. You know, with Jesus, the neighbor whom we are to love is not limited to members of our own group. With Jesus, the neighbor who loves us is not limited to members of our own group. The heart of discipleship is to love God and love other people. Now, it begins with a question. The NIV says, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" Now, I think that's an interesting question, because what do you do to earn an inheritance? Mm-hmm. Do you earn an inheritance?
No.
It is a what?
Yes.
It's a gift. Not through good behavior, well, sometimes, maybe, depending on the relative, right? But rather by relationship. Now, this seemingly simple question is a test. I don't think the man was necessarily hostile toward Jesus. He's not looking for information as much as he wants to find out what kind of answer that Jesus will give. And the question is really about a fundamental spiritual issue at the heart of Jesus' message of salvation. Now, you notice that Jesus does what? He does what? He flips the question right back to the expert, okay? And as so often happens, the professional religious person who asks Jesus the question already knows the answer. He performs right on cue, doesn't he? It reminds me kind of one of those. Have you ever had one of those for your kids, and you press the button on the doll or the stuffed animal, and it says the same thing every single time, right? "Mama," or "I want a drink," right? And this guy is exactly the same. You could wake him up, I think, in the middle of the night. You could press his nose, and he would say this answer. Love the Lord your God and love your neighbor as yourself. Deuteronomy 6:5 was a very familiar as to them as part of the Shema. That's the only thing I can say in Hebrew is the Shema. And they recited it twice daily as a sort of creed. And in combination with Leviticus 19:18, it produces this potent new manifesto for godly living. Now, Jesus says, correct, do this and you'll live. The lawyer had asked for something to do, but there's a problem there. Who do you know who can do this? Love God and love neighbor. Jesus is subtly making the point that nobody can actually do those commands. The disciples of Jesus cannot do that and be saved. No, instead they're saved, and then they're enabled by the Holy Spirit to obey those impossible commands. But instead of throwing himself on the mercy of God, this guy tries to justify himself and wriggle out of his predicament. Anybody ever do that to you? Okay, let's define it, right? He does that debating tactic, and basically he's going, okay, define your terms. What do you mean by neighbor? Who is it exactly that I am commanded to love? Now, while this conversation might have been over with the question asked and answered, the scribe wants more from the exchange, and so he asks a question. I wonder later if he said to himself, I wish I would have never asked. Now, I think most of us would be irritated by this exchange, but Jesus is our Lord and Savior, and he makes a brilliant teaching moment out of it. And he transitions into this parable without a hiccup. Now, in the Old Testament, it's important to know that in the Old Testament, neighbor usually meant a member of one's own community, a fellow Israelite. Neighbors weren't usually people outside the people of God. But for his disciples, Jesus expands that definition to literally include all people on God's earth. Now, we know this story, right? This story begins with a traveler, a man the audience would assume is Jewish. He's traveling down this barren, dangerous road. It's a steep descent of 17 miles through a desolate, rocky area. Okay, I kind of envision a Western. Does anybody else envision that, right? This Western, you know, you can just see it in your mind, can't you? It's barren, it's desolate, and behind all the rocks, right? Doesn't that happen on Westerns? Come on, some of you are Western experts here, right? The old ones, right? And they're behind the rocks. And attacked, the Greek literally means by men of violence. This man is stripped of everything. He's stripped of his money, he's stripped of his clothes, his pride, and nearly his life. Then I think what must have felt like to see a priest and a Levite pass by with neither one stopping to help. Now, most of us can think of excuses for the priest and the Levite as they ignored the victim. Maybe sometimes we even use these excuses ourselves. The priest is like, you know what, I think he's thinking to himself, I've been serving God all week at the temple, I want to get home, I'm pure, if I touch this guy, I'll be impure. It looks like he either is a dead body or soon to be. And in any case, it's just safer. Don't involve yourself with other people's problems. And besides, those bandits could be lurking behind another rock. And this is my fault. He's saying to himself, it's not my fault this guy got attacked. The second person is a temple helper, not a priest. But I think he's also concerned with ritual purity. And I think he had his own good reasons for passing right by. And a Jewish audience, having heard Jesus poke fun at religious professionals, they're thinking, okay, do you ever listen to a story and you're thinking, okay, where's he going with this? You're thinking, okay, I know who the next guy is going to be. The next guy is going to be just a Jewish guy next door, an ordinary guy. And his human response is going to put the priest and the Levite to shame. But Jesus brings a surprise on them. And the one who comes to help is, by the Jewish way of thinking, the last person in the world who would do the right thing, a Samaritan. Now, if we ask people today what the name Samaritan suggests, what would they say?
Good.
A good person, right? We think a Samaritan is someone who does something nice for somebody else. But that is precisely the opposite of what Jesus' original audience would have thought. Then if somebody had said Samaritan to a Jew, hostility instantly sprung up. See, the Jews saw themselves as pure descendants from Abraham, and these Samaritans are kind of what they would call half-breeds, because they descended from Jews from the northern kingdom who had intermarried with other people after Israel's exile. And that animosity only grew over grew with time. Charles Swindoll says this. Think about this. This is quite an example. He says the introduction of a Samaritan was as deliberately shocking as if a Southern preacher before the Civil War had set up a black hero to shame the pillars of white society. Whoa. We think, why should the Samaritan help this person? There is no logical reason why he should rearrange his plans and spend his money just to help an enemy, but mercy doesn't need reasons. When the Samaritan saw the suffering man, he had compassion. And the Samaritan loved those who hated him. He risked his life. He spent his own money. He was never publicly rewarded or honored, as far as we know. Now think about this. What would it look like if, again, he's a hated enemy of the Jews, but he rides up with a badly wounded Jew thrown across his donkey? What could people think? He had a good reason to be cautious of the reception he might meet in a Jewish inn, but I think his familiarity with the innkeeper suggests he was a regular visitor. He not only cared for this man's immediate need by giving the monetary equivalent of 2 days' wages, he offers to pay any additional expenses. This compassion is not just impulsive, it's practical, and it's thought through. The Samaritan wanted the wounded man to have no worries and to be looked after carefully. Now, after hearing these stories, I think we often imagine ourselves as one of the characters. Maybe we imagine ourselves as the one to help. Maybe even on certain days we say to ourselves, maybe I was the priest or the Levite who didn't help. But how many of us view ourselves as the one to be helped? Probably none of us. You know, for a Jew to be kind to a Samaritan might be unnatural, but such an act, they can say, oh, I'm smugly superior. But to be the recipient of the unconditional love from a Samaritan would take typical Jews far outside their comfort zone, because it challenges the very basis of Jewish identity as the true people of God. And I think a Jewish audience would regard it as particularly humiliating to receive such extravagant love from a Samaritan of all people. Reminds me, it must be football day. I didn't even think about that until, listen to this example. Maybe you remember this story from January 2019. Several hours before the Kansas City Chiefs playoff victory against the Indianapolis Colts, did I get the names right here? Okay, got the right teams. Offensive lineman Jeff Allen. How many of you heard this story? He was stranded in the snow, he needed help. And a good Samaritan, drives by, stops, and he offers to lend a hand. And this guy said, Dave Cochran said, I was driving down US Highway 40 and I saw a couple cars stuck. And I pulled one car out before that, then I saw another car stuck, and I told my old lady, we have to help this guy. Now Cochran, who was homeless, he is living in his truck with his girlfriend and his small dog, had no idea who was in the car. But he knew driving on snow-packed streets was a challenge for whoever was in the vehicle. With thousands of fans flocking to Arrowhead Stadium, right? Everybody was so excited that the Chiefs were in the playoffs, right? That Allen knew Allen was going to need help to get there before kickoff. And Cochran said, I just pulled over. I went to help him. Then he told me he was a Chiefs player. I didn't know he was a Chiefs player. I looked at him as a normal person, and I hoped he would do the same for me like I had done for him. Now, Cochran may have hit a rough patch, but it hasn't made him bitter, as he proved with a small act of kindness. Didn't even see him on TV. He was quite a down-to-earth man, nice man. And after the game, Allen took to social media. He was hoping to track down Cochran and give him a small token of appreciation. He said, I want to give him tickets to the AFC Championship game for helping, but don't have a way to contact him. Because, right, the Chiefs won that. Is that right, Dan? Dan's always my... Some of you are much more experts in areas than I am, including sports, okay? But Cochran said, I love this. He said, that's a natural habit for me, is to help people. I don't expect anything in return. All I was expecting was a thank you. Now, trying to evade responsibility, the man asked, who is my neighbor? But Jesus asked, which of these three men was a neighbor to the victim? The big question is, to whom can I be a neighbor? It has nothing to do with geography, citizenship, race, wherever people need us. There we can be neighbors and, like Jesus Christ, show mercy, just like the guy with the Chiefs player. When the expert in the law replied, he said, literally, the one who did mercy with him. Did you notice that he doesn't say the word Samaritan? Have you noticed that? It's like he doesn't want to say that word. He's so uncomfortable, he won't say it directly. The Samaritan was full of mercy. Yes, the priest and Levite might have felt pity, but they did nothing. Now, I would dare say that Jesus, the man, the priest, the Levite, they'd all agree. They all agree about what the summary of the law is, but what they don't agree about is the application of the law. What is crucial is our attitude, no matter what the person's need. We're to be like the Samaritan, full of compassion, and we cannot become calloused. Now, I think this story here reflects the nature of Jesus' mission as a Savior, coming to a lost and helpless world that rejected him. The parable is not only a call to help those in need, it's a warning not to become self-satisfied in your own devoutness. This parable is a call to universal benevolence, a call to see beyond social and ethnic stereotypes. Of course, the lawyer wanted to make the issue seem somewhat more complex and philosophical, but Jesus made it simple and practical. He moved it from duty to love, from debating to doing. It's a call to action. Attending a convention in Indianapolis, D.L. Moody, Pastor D.L. Moody, asked singer Iris Sankey to meet him at 6 o'clock one evening at a certain street corner. And when Sankey arrived, Mr. Moody put him on a box and he asked him to sing, and it was not long before a crowd gathered. And Moody spoke briefly. He invited the crowd to follow him into the nearby opera house. And before long, the auditorium was filled, and the evangelist preached the gospel to spiritually hungry people. And when delegates to the convention started to arrive, Moody stopped preaching and said, "Now we must close, as the brethren of the convention wish to come and discuss the question, how to reach the masses." Ouch. You know, it all depends on your outlook. To the thieves, this traveling Jew was a victim to be exploited, so they attacked him. To the priest and Levite, he was a nuisance to avoid, so they ignored him. But to the Samaritan, he was a neighbor to love and to help, so he took care of him. While we may think only of the high cost of caring, it's far more costly not to care. The priest and the Levite lost the opportunity to become better men and good stewards of what God had given them. They could have been a good influence in a bad world, but they chose to be a bad influence. You think about this. The Samaritan's one deed of mercy has inspired sacrificial ministry all over the world. Again, even people who are not Christian use the word Samaritan as someone who does something kind for someone else. See, God sees to it that no act of loving service in Christ's name is ever lost. What Jesus said to the lawyer, he says to us, go and keep on doing likewise. May our hearts be full of love for God and our neighbor. Amen. Friends, let's say together what we believe.
We believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. We believe that God's love is powerful beyond measure. God not only preserves the world, God continually attends to it. God commands us to care for the earth in ways that reflect God's loving care for us. We are responsible for ensuring gifts are used fairly and wisely, that no creature suffers from the abuse of what we are given, and that future generations may continue to enjoy the abundance and goodness of the earth. In praise to God.
Amen. All right, are there joys and concerns to be shared this morning? Peggy, we're glad to see Peggy back from Belize, and Warren's off happily doctoring evil, so we're missing him this morning. But Peggy was sharing with me about a young man. Why don't you share, Peggy?
Some of you have just heard me tell the story. One of the most touching patients that we saw was a young man. I think Daniel's about 8 years old. They think it started with an ear infection that wasn't treated or not treated properly anyway. He started with an abscess in the back of his head behind his ear and has gone clear around to the front. When we saw him Monday morning, his eye was starting to swell. We gave him an injection of antibiotics, an oral antibiotics. He was running a high fever. We saw him back on Tuesday. He was running 103 fever. His eye was completely swollen shut, and he was starting to form a pustule in the front from the infection. They worked to try to get him to the hospital. They debated whether he would get better care at our clinic or in what they considered this closest hospital, which was not even the main hospital in the city. They finally found somebody who could drive him the 45 minutes to the hospital. We found out they kept him one night. We don't know what's happened since then, but we just pray that that abscess heals. We left him with antibiotics and Tylenol. And I hope that he doesn't lose his eye and that his abscess heals. So, things we take for granted.
Not really that an ear infection, never thinking about an ear infection manifesting itself that way in the body. People pray. Pray for him and others who touch him that week. Are there other joys and concerns this morning?
Well, I have a joy in Philip Vincent. We prayed for my friend Jenny a few weeks ago. I did hear that she, treatment is, has been working. So she's somewhat better, but she's a long way. So she still needs a prayer. But I told her that we have prayer warriors in our church, and I was hoping that she would notice the difference. And when she wrote that to me, I'll remind her. We'll get back on it.
We'll keep praying for her. All right, thank you for that. And Lisa, I'm sorry, your friend Rod is on here, and he has passed away, right? So we're praying for his family.
And he was his daughter, Shelby. She's only 25, and having to do everything through the stage, and the whole funeral, the wonderful funeral Friday in celebration of life.
Okay. We'll pray for you too, Lisa. Others today. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer together. We're going to start with a quiet time. You can have your eyes open or look out of the lake, of course. And then start our time of prayer. Gracious God, as we look out into your beautiful, onto your beautiful earth, as we hear the trees, as we see the beautiful lake, as we experience your creation, Lord, we are truly thankful today. And we thank you that you are a God who has made this creation for us to enjoy and for your glory. Thank you for each person gathered here today and for the blessings you've bestowed upon us. We thank you for our church and our church family. And ask that you be with each one of them, especially this day. Lord, we are thankful for all that you've blessed us with. And as we give you thanks and praise for so many things, we lift up to you those today who are in need of your tender, loving care. We especially lift up to you those who are battling cancer. We think of Doug, for Ryan, Sumia, Rhonda, Bob. Lord, there are others. John O'Neill. There are others, Lord, in our community, in our world, who need your tender, loving care. We pray, Lord, that we would be a neighbor to them and to anyone we encounter that needs your love, regardless of how different we are from them. We lift up to you, Merrill, as he continues to recover from burns. We lift up to you, Mary Ellen's friend, Jenny, and we pray especially today that she would feel the powerful anointing of you upon her today, that she would feel the prayers that are being prayed for her. Lord, we lift up to you those who were ministered to by Misty and Peggy and Warren and their group to Belize. We especially lift up to you, Daniel, and we pray that these antibiotics, Lord, would take hold, that the abscess would drain off, that the abscess would heal, that the infection would be gone. We pray for his family. Lord, we think of those who are grieving this day, and we especially lift up to you, Rod's family. We lift up to you, Shelby, as she deals with all the details that come with a death, even as she grieves. Lord, we know there are others today who are grieving. Grieving not only the passing of a loved one, but of a dream, of a relationship, many things, Lord, and we lift them up to you this day. Lord, we thank you for the mission and ministries that our church is involved in. We think of the McCutcheons, for Joel and Krista, for Kati and Sophie. We pray your blessing upon them as they minister so many, especially missionaries that are going out in the field. We think of those at Travelers Oasis and Kikuswi Schools in Kenya, for the Eye Servants Organization in Belize, for our food pantries in Tanzania.
town, especially Christ Covered. We lift up to you the Pregnancy Center. And for all those who are doing good works in your name, Lord, we thank you for that. And again, we ask that you would open our eyes and our ears to ways that we can be neighbors to those around us. We lift up to you those who are in nursing homes and assisted living, especially Mary Ann and Marilyn, Shirley and Odette, Bud and Dolores, Merlin and Velma and Pat. We give you thanks for the care they're receiving, and we ask that you would allow them to know that their church family loves them greatly. Thank you for this time of worship today, for being together in this place, for the beauty of your creation, and for all that you've given us. We lift up all these prayers in the powerful name of our Savior Jesus Christ, the one who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Yes.
The moment you said, or look at the lake, a beautiful white swan all the way down the river. Just the very moment you said that.
That is amazing.
I mean, the lake, whatever this is.
Yes. Yeah. It looks like a river right now. A big pond? That's beautiful. Thank you for sharing that.
Yeah, how'd you do that?
That's God. Friends, we are thankful today for God, for swans, for this beautiful place. And we bring our offerings to God to say thank you. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us pray. God, we are truly grateful for these gifts. We're grateful that you enable us to be able to give back to you. Thank you for the gift of this swan and for the beauty of this place. In the name of Jesus, all God's people said,
Amen.
All right, let's join together in singing How Great Thou Art.
I see the stars, I hear
on the first Wednesday, right, Peggy, to sing and be a ding-a-ling. Let's pray, and this will serve as our blessing.
Can I share one more joy?
Yes, please.
I want to share with everybody who helped make all those fans, and I have more pictures, what a joy they were. We spread them to the people, but we used them in the clinic, and especially to the dental clinic, to just keep people cool.
Way to go. And we know that some of that was the kids, but some of you got assigned with coloring homework, didn't you? And
yes.
You did a very good job. Let's pray. God, we once again thank you for this opportunity to gather together, Lord, and to worship you and to praise your holy name. We thank you for this time, and we thank you also for this fellowship, for the good food that's been prepared. We thank you for a time of fellowship and fun, and we thank you for the food and for the hands that have prepared it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And now receive God's blessing. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Let's stand and sing Jesus Loves Me together.
Can you see around me?
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, this I know, as he loved so long ago, taking children on his knee, saying, let them come to me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me. He will stay close beside me on my way. He's prepared a home for me, and someday his face I'll see. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Amen.
Everybody, there's drinks, there's iced tea, there's water in the blue, there's pop in the next cooler. And if you enter from the north door, there's plates and napkins and silverware. And then the women, I think, have stuff to put out of the refrigerator.
Awesome.